Hi, this is Amish Agarwal. I'm an advocate. I practice law in Delhi. And today I wanted to talk about the great scam parade, which is Shaadi.com. And of course, I don't mean that Shaadi.com itself is the perpetrator. You know, it's kind of a, you know, concept which is synonymous with the way how Xerox, the company, when it started photocopiers and it became the most popular photocopying company. People used to say, let's just Xerox it rather than saying photocopy it. In a very similar way, Shaadi.com, I believe, has become the number one, you know, whatever, because it's synonymous with, you know, arranged marriage online. And so there's, of course, there's Shaadi.com, there's BharatMatrimony.com, all of these websites, they have a very common theme of people running these massive, massive scams. Now, of course, we've all heard about the OLX scam and all these other goods scams that you keep seeing happen all the time. But, you know, these matrimonial website scams, and let's just call them for the purpose of convenience, Shaadi.com scams, are much more bigger and much more troublesome because they all happen to a great extent within the ambit of the law. Just because it is legal does not mean it's not a scam. And the reason why is the intent of the parties. Now, I'm giving a little disclaimer. I mean for these scams to be gender neutral. However, the people who have reached out to me, I believe 9 out of 10 will be men, and perhaps one will be a woman who has also scammed. The genders which are affected are both, I believe, because of the now contemporary female friendly laws of the country, men suffer a little more than women in these scams. And I'll talk about how women suffer as well and in what ways they also suffer as well. Now, what happens with men is I've had calls from several overseas Indians who tell me that they got married to a person that they met on Shaadi.com and they had a nice honeymoon. They go, they stay there for a little while. It depends from place to place, but a couple of days, a couple of months, a couple of years, the woman goes back to her country, that is India, without any rhyme or reason. She ditches the man and then files all the cases that and seeks all the remedies which are available to her. And in all these cases, from the evidences I've seen, from the discussions that I've had, I can know for 100% certainty that the woman is accusing the man falsely in those cases. And this brings me to wonder and to perhaps warn the population out there, of all of you people who are considering getting married on a matrimonial website, who have met somebody. I have a client who met somebody on Shaadi.com. The thing did not work out. In fact, let me mention it. BharatMatrimony.com met the woman who claimed to be a, you know, completely different person than what she turned out to be. When he discovered her fraud, he cancelled the wedding, and then she filed several cases upon him, such as, I believe a couple of them were attempt to rape, molestation, and a couple of other cases. And there is pending litigation even right now. So, you know, there's another client who called me up and told me that maybe just like a month or two into living together in the US, the wife came back home, again filed all these cases. The man gives out substantial amounts of maintenance. And I believe that NRI men are specifically targeted because after understanding the laws of the country, certain women with malicious intention get married to these men, and after maybe just a day or two, a week, a month of staying together with the husband, they come back to India and they seek maintenance. And immediately, even if there is perhaps some person called out to me and said, if we haven't lived together for more than a week, or, you know, if she went back immediately, why am I now liable to pay maintenance? The law says the moment you are married, the moment a valid marriage takes place, if a wife is unable to maintain herself, you are then duty bound to maintain her, unless there are these ABC reasons why, you know, she is not entitled to maintenance. But most of the times you will have to then pay maintenance to your wife. And in these kind of situations, of course, to put extra additional pressure on the husband, the wife, on a lot of situations, in a lot of cases, she also goes ahead and files a lot of false cases of dowry harassment, of under the Domestic Violence Act. She seeks maintenance under Section 125 of the CRPC, as well as under the Hindu Marriage Act when she files for a divorce. Now, because of all of these things, a lot of times I've seen husbands have conceded and given lakhs and lakhs and lakhs of rupees as full and final compromised settlement. And because of this, I believe is, you know, a major reason why especially NRI men and even otherwise men with high earning incomes, if they are getting married and you are going on a matrimonial website, and this is especially more concerning, and I make this video with a certain sense of urgency in my head because on a very, very regular basis, I keep listening to people when they tell me that during this lockdown time, so many marriages are taking place with the mindset of the parents that in this corona might take us. And that is why it is better that we get our children off, married off as soon as possible. And I'm seeing a lot of marriages like this take place. And, you know, in a situation like this, you're talking to somebody on a matrimonial website, you've met them maybe twice or thrice. I believe it's not enough to find out the entire story about the person. Coming on to the woman angle, and this is not in any way less than what a man is suffering, because the way the woman suffers in these situations might be a little different, but the intensity is, I believe, almost the same. I have had from time to time females come to me and tell me that they were talking to this man, they were establishing a connection, and they had pretty much made up their mind, and the couple had kind of agreed to go for the marriage. And at that point of time, the man or his relative or some other situation would arise where the man would be in some dire need of money. And just as you see with perhaps OLX or any of these other places, where then when there is a little bit of investment, when the person is getting a very, very good deal on the internet, he is likely to jump at it. And in these kind of situations, when the woman feels that I am about to get married to the man, he is facing some sort of financial emergency right now, let me help him because I am going to be wedded to him, I'm going to be his wife for times to come. And though she goes ahead and she extends financial help, maybe emotional help or whatever it is, but the financial help is what becomes a problem, because there have been numerous reports. I have had clients who've told me that they have met men on Shaadi.com or any other matrimonial website, and after a few weeks or months of talking, a couple of lakhs were sought. The case seemed very, very genuine, extremely educated, extremely well earning women who also got carried away in the name of love, in the name of doing their duty to their soon to be husband, and they also get duped. And of course, they do have a remedy of approaching the police under Section 420 of the IPC, and you know they can go ahead and they can try to hopefully track down the person. Of course, there are a lot of bluff masters which are roaming around now and who cover their tracks really, really well. But a bigger problem that I feel comes with to men on this specific aspect, which is that whatever happens, at least the woman is availing all her remedies in law, and the time for the man to use the evidence which he has in his favor against the woman to prove that what she is saying about the cruelty that was meted out to her, or the violence, be it physical or emotional, which was meted out to her, was actually incorrect and completely made up, is all for at the time of trial. And that comes a long way ahead, till the time the man has to pay lakhs and lakhs, sometimes even crores of rupees as maintenance, sometimes even alimony, and he has to, you know, come and face the police, and all of these other things happen, because of which it becomes a tad more complicated for husbands, as I would put it. In any case, the solution perhaps is to exercise as much caution as possible. Be as paranoid as I am in all my other videos about every other person, about every other organization. Whenever a deal seems too good to be true, always assume that it always is. And there are a bunch of things that otherwise you can also do. You can go online and you can perhaps, you know, try to understand. You can, you know, do a little bit of stalking, a healthy amount of stalking for your future life partner, I would say is completely legal and is completely, you know, it is moral, and it is something that you should definitely do. It's very, very advisable. Apart from that, one definite advice would be to not rush into things. The coronavirus is no reason to get your son or your daughter married off to someone who could potentially be a complete disaster. Apart from that, of course, there are legal strategies. There are, you know, quasi prenuptial agreements that you can get signed, and you can kind of, you know, you can solidify, you can put into writing certain aspects about the marriage which can help a man as well as a woman when they are getting married, so that, you know, there can be fewer disputes, there can be less chances of fraud, and, you know, certain other angles to it as well. But you know, one thing to know for sure is that marriage is not the sacrament that it used to be. It has now become a hotbed of disputes, of conflict, all the time. In fact, I make half of my revenue from these kind of situations. I know how bad it can get when it does get bad. So remember, don't get carried off so easily.